All right, so today we are going to be talking about symbiotic relationships. You should have updated your table of contents. Page 98, you do not have yet, so you will get that. Mike, when you come back, come this way, because I'm taping. All right, so today we are going to take some notes on symbiotic relationship. If you would go ahead and put your title to your notes as such, symbiotic relationship notes. All right, so in talking about symbiotic relationships, we're going to take some notes, but first, just to get you kind of thinking about what we mean by symbiotic relationship, in order to have a relationship, you have to have what? Another organism, another being. So let's just take a listen. I think this song best describes symbiotic relationships. What you think?
I think about all the time, think you may need what? All of mine. Hate to say, you know the love is blind. I'm about to see, I close my eyes. They can see you in it all. Must have me got a sign to make every day your birthday. Every night your Valentine.
We try that we could be somewhere to climb this. It's warm, long as you around.
So this song really does best describe symbiotic relationships. There's no we without you and I. And we're going to talk about the you and the I in this weave of the symbiosis or the symbiotic relationships that we're going to be looking at. So symbiotic relationship notes, a couple things that we want to write here. First of all, in order to understand something, we do really want to know the origin of a word. So symbiosis comes from actually two Greek words. And the Greek words mean living and within. So in order to have a relationship, you need to first of all be living, and they live within one another, or with each other. Now, symbiotic relationships like Jeremiah's songs, it talks about there's no we without you and I. That you and I is not like you and your long lost friend, you and your friend that you talk to every couple of years, but y'all still stay close. It's talking about a connection, a partnership. So symbiotic relationship describes close relationships. And we said in order for a relationship to be a relationship, it must involve what? Just one person?
Two.
Not for this. Between two organisms of different species. I'll give you guys a moment to get caught up writing that. Are we good? Everybody good?
No.
All right, then what we're going to do is we're just going to take a look at a short video. And this video is actually going to talk about these types of symbiotic relationships. And then we're going to come together and we're going to put them in notes.
We're in the ocean of Southeast Asia, getting ready to search for a fish that lives in a place so dangerous that most other fish won't even come near it. Ready?
Let's go diving. And after a bit of searching, I finally found it. The clownfish, or anemone fish as it's also called. The beautiful tentacles of the anemone are actually deadly to most fish. The tentacles have stinging organs called nematocysts, which fire tiny darts into fish that brush by. This stinging ability protects anemones from predators and helps them capture prey for food. But how can clownfish hide in such a dangerous place?
Well, that's because clownfish have a symbiotic relationship with anemones that is so important that clownfish are almost always found among anemones. Symbiotic relationships are interactions between two species that can benefit either one or both species. Symbiotic relationships are divided up into three major categories.
Parasitism benefits one species while the other is harmed. Like ticks, for example. There are many examples here in the ocean. Take parasitic fish lice, for example, that cling to a host fish and feed on its body fluids. Amazingly, fish will sometimes find a cleaner fish or a cleaner shrimp to help remove the parasites from their scales, mouth, and gills. When this happens, a mutualistic relationship is formed between the fish and the cleaner organism. Mutualism is a symbiotic relationship in which both species benefit from the relationship. This bird here eats the tick, which benefits the cow. In our fish example, the host fish is clean off its parasites, and the cleaner fish gets a free meal. Both species benefit. But not the sea lice anymore. Hey, I already brushed my teeth today. The third symbiotic relationship is commensalism. Commensalism benefits one organism, but the other one is neither harmed nor helped. You might have had a bug hitchhiking on you at some point without knowing it. An example here in the ocean is when remoras hitch a ride on sharks, big rays, or turtles. The remora attaches itself with a disc on its head and then hitch a ride and feed off the food scraps that the host animal leave behind.
So the sharks are not affected by the remoras being there, but the remoras get a free ride and a free meal. Sounds good to me.
So back to our clownfish. Clownfish are protected from predators by living among anemones, and in exchange, the clownfish chase away fish and other animals that could harm the anemone. What kind of symbiotic relationship is this? That's right, mutualistic.
Okay, but we still have one important question to answer. How can the clownfish be immune to the anemone's sting? Well, a clownfish must first get used to its host anemone by developing a protective mucus coating.
kind of like when we use sunscreen. And there are two possible explanations for how this happens. The first explanation is that the clownfish secretes its own mucus, which lacks the substance that makes the anemone fire its stinging nematocyst. It's as if the clownfish had a protective force field or invisible cape. And the second explanation is that the clownfish uses mucus produced by the anemone. The unprotected clownfish initially touches the anemone with its fins, even getting stung slightly at first, but over time gains the protective mucus coating.
Symbiotic relationships happen everywhere, even in our own bodies. Did you know that every time you eat yogurt, you're actually filling up your digestive tract with symbiotic bacteria? That's right, you become the host of these natural bacteria, and they help you process and digest the food that you eat every day. Alright, so next time you go outside, stop and look around and see how many symbiotic relationships you can spot around you and record what they are. And remember, never stop exploring your world.
Alright, so now, looking at those, that video, we should be able to look at three kinds of symbiosis. Go ahead and put that title underneath. Three kinds of symbiosis. What was one of them? Mutualism. What else? Commensalism. Parasitism. So the one that I'm going to start with is commensalism. Now, for commensalism, this, you can think of the word maybe common. For this one, who remembers how this one was described? So what happened? The fish was taken around and the other fish. So how did this relationship work? Was the other one harmed? Was the other one affected at all? Okay, so for commensalism, one benefits and other unaffected. There's no harm, there's no foul with the other. It's not helped or harmed. This is often called a one-sided symbiosis. In some cases, for this one, the benefited organism usually uses the other for protection or transportation. So, for example, Brianna, I know that you're struggling over there with this. This is a whale. Okay? The whale. This is the eye of the whale. Well, this is what I'm going to put. That's my eye of the whale. Here's my little blowhole. And what happens with the whale? Who remembers seeing something on the video? Well, these little barnacles, they actually get stuck to a whale. Or actually, these little parasites get stuck to a whale. And then your barnacles actually come on. These are barnacles. They and they eat the parasites. Can I move to the next one? Alright, our second one that we're going to look at. Is mutualism. What word do we hear in mutualism?
Mutual.
So what happens here? Mutual. What do you think happens here?
Equal.
Oh. Both organisms benefit. Some of the examples that you heard, you can write down these examples and you can draw it. One would be the bacteria in our digestive tract. That bacteria is there to eat the germs and all that stuff that we come from our food. It eats that, so it helps us to better digest food. Helps us to better digest food, and it also feeds that bacteria. Another benefit or another mutualistic relationship would be what does this do? Flower doesn't make honey. Takes the pollen from the flower so that it can take it back to its honeycomb to make honey. But how does it help the flower? Doesn't clean it. What is the pollen of the flower? You learned this in sixth grade. It's what? Huh? Yeah, it's nectar for the bee, but what is it for? What does it do for the flower? Pollinate, which is the plant's version of making more flowers. Pollinate is like sperm of the flower. It helps spread it all out so that it can make more flowers. All right, and then our third and final one that we're going to discuss is parasitism. Another one about mutualism that you probably can better identify as well is dogs and humans. That's a mutualistic relationship as well. What do we provide for dogs? Home, shelter, food, all of that great stuff. What do they provide for us? Companionship. Security, all of that. All right, so the third type is parasitism. And with parasitism, what is that? One organism benefits while the other one is harmed. One thing I do want you to add with mutualistic relationships is those are long-term. It's not like short-term, that's a long-term relationship, so make sure you add that. So, here we have one organism. The organism that benefits, what do you think that's called? Parasite. And the other, what is that called?
Host.
It's a host, good. And sometimes dies. Oftentimes the parasite needs the host to be alive so that they can stay alive, but then oftentimes the parasite gets what it needs and it dies. They just die off. So it kills the organism. So this would represent, an example would be you and your parents. They're your host, you're the parasite, you're killing them. No?
No, it doesn't work.
We're not killing y'all. You're not giving us anything. We are hosting your room. We're hosting our wallet for you to dig in it. We're hosting our refrigerator for you to eat all of our food. We are having absolutely no benefit from this. And now that y'all here, no, your relationship obviously will be a mutualistic relationship. We both do. We love to see you grow and thrive, and also we have to give you the things that you need: food, shelter, love, all that stuff. No, because then they it wouldn't be a relationship. They both are hungry. That's parasitic. I've never been bit by a mosquito. That feels good.
No, like when you scratch it.
You're scratching it, though. That's not the mosquito that's giving you that. It's you doing the scratching. No, but it's you doing the scratching to Darian that's making you feel good because you're scratching it. But you're scratching it because it itches, and that's what the mosquito gave you, the itch. Alright, so an example of this would be, alright, so here's my dog. Alrighty, nope, this is what I'm drawing. It's not a dog.
It's a hand.
It's a hand. And then we have our mosquito. So you could draw a dog and a tick. You could draw a mosquito and a hand. That's the mosquito, you know, biting a person. All right, mosquito. Mosquito. Not mosquito, it's actually mosquito. All right, so let's then take a look at a short video of a parasitic relationship. Just because I like to gross you out.
Our parasitized caterpillar has spent the last 12 days gorging itself. It now appears profoundly obese. But this
reason why
is
because the parasite's eating everything that it gives.
The glomerata wasp larvae lie just under its skin. Each is the size of a grain of rice, but together they account for over a third of the caterpillar's weight. The larvae have not yet finished growing and need to keep their host alive. So although they feast on the caterpillar's blood, they have been careful not to touch a single one of its vital organs. This uneasy truce will not last. Within days, the larvae are fully matured. Suddenly, they begin to stir into action. For the past 2 weeks, this surrogate womb has protected them, but now they no longer need it. To complete the next stage of their life cycle, they must break out.
Concise face.
The caterpillar's thick skin should be a solid barrier to the parasitic wasp larvae. But as their bodies have grown, they have developed tiny, saw-like teeth.
You could stop looking if it's about to gross you
These
out.
These jagged jaws are for one job only.
Here it comes.
Cutting their way out. Stroke by stroke, the larvae slice.
It's over. It's over, Brianna.
Layers of skin.
It's not over.
A the same time, they release chemicals that like paralyze a bad character the caterpillar.
That you can't stop looking at. Like the...
As the larvae break through, there is nothing it can do.
What do you think is going to happen to the caterpillar?
Free at last.
The larvae definitely
enter a new phase of development.
Dead.
They swiftly spin silken cocoons. These will provide the perfect environment for their final transformation.
All right.
Wait, I want to see the final transformation.
Oh, we're good. All right, so symbiotic relationships, although we have three types of symbiotic relationships, they could fall under two categories. One category is, I'm gonna kind of just split this in half. Make sure you write this title. One is endosymbiosis. The other one is ectosymbiosis. What do you think endosymbiosis is? Inside, something inside. So here, one species lives the endo inside the other. This would be, yeah, like what we just seen. Or, you know, we can give another example. Protozoan, that's a type of protist. We talked about those before. Living inside termites to help digest the wood they eat. Ectosymbiosis would be what? Yep, exactly. One species lives outside the other. And the example we can definitely give for that is like ticks and dogs. Or humans and mosquitoes. Very important that now that you put sunscreen on with the Zika virus going around. Another example would be like lice and scalps that Naya ate at the beginning of the year. Remember that, John? It's not a raisin, it's lice. Any questions about this? Can I move on? Now, wait a moment. Lice in the scalp. Skin. Over here, to help digest wood. The number of termites eat wood. Are we all good? So again, out of the three types of symbiotic relationships, those three types would fall under these, either endosymbiosis or ectosymbiosis. It's going to happen on the outside of the organism or on the inside of the organism. All right, am I good? Yes? Okay. And then lastly, because we are talking about ecology, and what is ecology again? Study of what? What's that something? What? Okay, so what's an ecosystem? What do we mean? The study of what?
Okay, what about organisms?
How they interact
with each other, not only each other, their environment. We need to be able to tie this in together. So you want to put impact on ecosystems. Because symbiotic relationships definitely have an impact on our ecosystem because they're organisms interacting with one another. So symbiotic relationships
physically change ecosystems. For every action, there is going to be a resulting change. Think about the food web. Those are also relationships within an ecosystem. And this change would be a reaction that alters. So the change is going to alter. For every action, there is a resulting change. Let's see, we take this off. I've already put change in the ecosystem. It's going to basically change the makeup. Give me an example really quickly. Based on the three different types, give me an example how a symbiotic relationship can actually alter the ecosystem. Speak up. Exactly. He said we, and within the food web, cows give us energy because we eat them. We eat that beef, that gives us energy. But if there's a lot of parasitic cows out there damaging those cows, that could possibly wipe out that type of food from the food web, and we can no longer get that, correct? Mm-hmm. On the flip side, cows also have, they have a organism within them that helps them to digest as well. What if that, how something happened to that organism and the cows couldn't digest that, then that their hay that they eat, then that possibly would also wipe out the cow, which then would affect us and any other type of animal and ecosystem that eats the cow, correct? All right, so on your computers, you are then going to be able to practice identifying ecosystems. So on your computer, I'm going to take you to where you need to look at on the website, and I'm going to give out a sheet. What you do not finish in class today is homework. So on the website, underneath lesson attachment, and I'm setting you up so that you have it so that you do not need internet when you get home, you're going to get a sheet that looks like this. If you scroll down, I'm sorry, actually, no, you don't need to scroll down. If you click on symbiotic relationships, it's going to pull up a document that looks like this as soon as it loads, and you'll be able to save it. Pass this out. And what you're going to do at each station, because you're going to scroll through the stations, it's going to ask you some questions on the sheet that's on my website. Yours is going to pop up a little bit different because I'm logged into my Google Drive. So I'll give mine a moment. But on this sheet, if you notice, each station is asking some questions. These questions are going to be based on the information that you gather from the pictured stations that you're currently looking at and ready to download. Does that make sense? There's some gruesome pictures, and then there's some information that you must read. Any questions on what it is that you are going to be doing? All right, then you currently actually have about 10 minutes to be working.